So I will start now. Okay, so this is my agenda. I will briefly give a short introduction to the ITO-free organic solar cell concept we use, how we make it and how we encapsulate. Report on an updated results on the stability under sulfur plasma lamp, where we had already years ago very nice results. Then we learned some lessons from the very, very constructive ISOS 3 collaboration, results on thermal stress, UV stress, and which component really is the degrading component, and also some very preliminary results on autostability and damped testing. So we have this ITO-free concept. We were really very early concerned by just analyzing the cost structure of OPV that ITO is one of the components which must to go out, and because the second most expensive part was the encapsulation, which is probably not so easy to get out, so we focused on getting rid of ITO, and this was a concept we came up with. We use a metallized substrate with a mainly aluminum electrode with thin capping layers. Esther showed the old publication. We started with titanium as a thin capping, and then we discovered that chromium is giving some advantages in terms of stability. And as a transparent electrode ITO replacement, we use P.PSS in combination with a silver grid. And of course, these devices can be encapsulated by either using glass substrates and or flexible film, barrier films, and you could use, of course, epoxy glues, where you have a more sheet-like process, or with pressure-sensitive adhesive, which is, of course, very nice and easy to use, but has also some issues. One remark, in this structure, of course, the lateral column collection is occurring in the P.PSS layer, so the conductivity of this layer is very important for these devices, and the average transport length in the P.PSS layer is about 1 millimeter. And in usual vertical device decks, the transport length in P-DOT is only a few nanometers, the thickness of the film. So several years ago, we had already quite promising results on a sulfur plasma lamp. This is now updated. We have until now more than 12,000 hours. The oldest device with a glass-glass encapsulation, the initial efficiency, it's a P3HT PCBM device. It was 2.7, so it's quite okay. And of course, if you dare, the result is you have 12,000 hours, and for the glass device, less than 10% reduction. And this LITOS you can roughly translate into a lifetime of 12 years if you just use the LITOS, which is, of course, not really giving you the right number for your lifetime outdoors. But if you would extrapolate to T80, I don't know, it ends up at something like 20 years or so. But I think it's important to know that OPV can transfer light into electricity for these light doses. It's an important message. So we were quite optimistic when this ISO 3 collaboration started, and then we were really disappointed because our device was among the best performing, but it was also among the fastest degrading. And this really puzzled us at the beginning, and we thought what could be the reason, and then we checked there was a series of papers, so this was more the result on the degradation, and we saw okay it's degrading, and Harald's group made this imaging studies, and there was a clear signature that current collection in this Elbic image that the current collection after degradation is only occurring very close to the grid, and there were two hypotheses still published, and this was one obvious explanation was an increased series resistance of the P.PSS electrode, or there could of course also be some interfacial issue where it's maybe not so straightforward to explain this pattern, but anyway it was a possibility which could happen, and there was also a Toff-Sims analysis done at Riese. And for these glass encapsulated devices like ours and the one from the Holst Center, there was no detectable oxygen ingress and any changes. So it was, of course, mentioned that this is, yeah, that the subtle changes at interfaces can, of course, change the device without being noticeable with this method, but at least there was not really oxygen coming in contrast to the flexible devices where you really see a clear trend. So we had two questions. What is the reason? Is it the higher temperature? Because the continuous illumination was at more or less 80 degrees because it was uncontrolled and a very strong light source with a lot of UV. And the second question, is it the UV light? And from the imaging, there were two possible explanations. Is it the interface at the chromium electrode, or is it the degradation of the P.PSS conductivity? So a very simple thing for us to check is, of course, put the solar cell in an oven at 85 degrees and see if it lasts. And as you can see here, it lasts for more than 10,000 hours without any change. So our conclusion was, okay, this is not the problem. And this, it works also with a flexible film encapsulation, in this case, the Fraunhofer Polo barrier. And the initial efficiencies are, again, between 2.5 and 2.8%. So it's reasonable devices. So this elevated temperature could not be the cause for this fast degradation during the ISOS 3 study. And this also makes somehow the degradation of the interface of the chromium, aluminum, chromium improbable because the mechanism anticipated was that P.PSS has residue water, and this is then released and makes a chemical reaction. And this should be somehow also accelerated if you increase the temperature. But of course, it's not a proof that it's not happening. So the next thing was, of course, to test the UV degradation. And this now really looks exactly like the result from the ISOS study. And again, the initial values you can see, it's a good usual voltage, currents, and fill factors. For fill factors a bit low for OPV devices, and we see this very fast degradation too here, and it's mainly in the fill factor and also in current. So it's really the same pattern as observed in this ISOS study. And of course, if you put a UV filter in this UV chamber, it's dark, so it's stable. but of course, it's an interesting question. How much you have to cut off. So there, if you see a degrading fill factor, and after the fill factor is lousy enough, also the current goes down. This the degradation of the current can also be explained by this fill series resistance problem if the fill factor is low enough. And there are, of course, different reasons, the carrier mobility of the blend or the sheet resistance of the P-dot. And for the current decrease, you could, of course, also think of photobleaching. But we heard in several talks for now that it's improbable, and we just made sure that it's also in these specific devices under these specific conditions not happening. And this is the result just of the optical spectroscopy. You see there is no change. So there is no bleaching. So we were, of course, for longer time scales, it might become an issue. But so what we investigated is, okay, what happens to the series resistance of the P-dot? And of course, we made encapsulated devices and unencapsulated devices. And so, okay, it's much faster, of course, for unencapsulated, but still the P-dot resistance changes orders of magnitude, even in this glass encapsulation. So it was pretty clear that this must play a role. And of course, there was a very nice publication by Andreas Elschner from HC Stark, formerly, and now Hereos. And he also investigated the spectral distribution. And it was clear that it's the UV part which harms the P-dot, and the visible part is not so important. And just a short explanation, Ohm's law. we deal with Ohm's law. So if you have an electrode with a finite resistance to collect your current, your solar cell elements will deliver a current which depends on the position, because if a current flows through the electrode, you have a voltage drop. You need some voltage to drive the current through this resistor. And this means that the potential of the solar cell depends on the location x. And you have these two differential equations which you need to solve. And just a scheme, if you are in an extreme case, very far away from the electrode, the solar cell could be even at VOC, so not delivering any current in the red curve. And close to the grid, of course, you have the JSC of an infinitesimal small cell. And the more you get, and the potential is, of course, zero at the finger edge short circuit. And then it goes first linear up because you have some resistance and the current needs to be transported through. And then it saturates at VOC and no current is delivered anymore. And this, of course, explains exactly the pattern observed in this Elbig imaging study. And then we thought, okay, we know what happens. And we put this in the values of our p-dot degradation into our program, with which we calculate also the module dimensions, where you really solve these differential equations. And the result was the device should degrade faster than we observed. And this raises, of course, some questions. We trusted Ohm's law, so we didn't deal with that. And we also trusted the program, that we didn't make an error in this. So we thought of what could be wrong with the measurement of the p-dot resistance. And one thing is, of course, we took more care to really avoid that p-dot PSS comes out of the package, so you have ingress through the p-dot layer. Of course, the other point is if you have just a single transparent p-dot layer and put it into a UV chamber where there's a lot of metal reflecting the UV light, it might be a different situation than if you put a complete solar cell because you have the photoactive absorber underneath. And we calculated this. If the photon dose is equivalent in such a single sheet or not. And of course, we made devices also with a photoactive layer and a p-dot on top and checked the degradation rate again. And this is the result. It's both encapsulated devices. And if you have only the p-dot, the degradation is quite fast. And it's significantly slowed down if you have the photoactive layer underneath. And this is, according to our optical simulations, very probably due to the lower light dose. There might be some other fancy stabilizing effect, but I think the optical component explains most of it, at least. To answer the second question, is the mobility a problem? We used C-leaf charge extraction by linear increasing voltage. Just a brief recapitulation. You use a ramp, a voltage ramp in reverse direction to drive out charge carriers, and you get this measurement curve with a capacitive current, the rectangle, and you get some extraction current. And from this maximum time, from the time where the maximum of this extraction current occurs, you can derive with this formula the mobility. And we analyzed this, and the result was the mobility is also changing. So, and on this time scale, it changes about a factor of three. And then we have to comment that the C-leaf method has also its problems, and there's a recent publication on the C-leaf method, and they show that traps can really alter your result significantly without changing the DC mobility. So the C-leaf curves here are calculated C-leaf curves. If you just introduce traps, and you have seen yesterday the poster outside, it's a very similar effect of as compared to doping. So it looks that the Tmax is shifting, but the mobility is kept constant in these calculations. So if you analyze your experimental results, it mimics reduced mobility, but it's not the mobility which is reduced, but you just have more traps. So we have to take these numbers with care. Yeah? And therefore, we made, again, these calculations. But now we solved really the two-dimensional problem. We have the current extraction in the vertical dimension through the active layer. And then we have current collection on this lateral scale through the p-dot. And this was solved, in this Centaurus software. And the outcome is if we model just keeping the mobility constant and taking the measured series resistance increase of P.PSS, we get a quite good match. And if we also take into account for the changed mobility, again, the degradation should be faster than the observed degradation. So this is for the fill factor the same. If you just take the mobility constant and the series resistance increase of the P-dot, it matches perfectly with the simulations and experiments. And if you additionally put in this changing mobility, you get a faster degradation. So this is for us a very strong hint that the mobility measurement by CLIF is not giving the steady state mobility, but is only giving reflecting a transient effect of traps. Which is, of course, also interesting because we learned that these traps may be not so important in crystalline materials, but on long time scales, I'm not so sure if they don't play a role at all. So, of course, we were left to solve the problem. And there are several strategies to avoid this UV-induced degradation. One simple solution is, of course, use a thicker P-dot to have higher conductivity and also more material, which can absorb the UV and just sacrifice some capping layer or so. But of course, in our concept, we need the high transparency of the P-dot, and we would have much lower efficiency if we use it. Of course, we could just make the grid dimension smaller to have less resistance. But of course, this is very dangerous because then you will have a stable device for some time, and suddenly it starts to degrade very fast. So then extrapolation, of course, is not really valid anymore. And another very elegant solution would, of course, be to use UV-stabilized P.PSS formulations, which are available from Hereos and also Agfa. But unfortunately, up to now, none of them worked so far because the interface formation is really, really critical. If you put P-dots on top of photoactive layers, it's also common if you use high-efficiency materials, it's not always working nicely with P-dot on top. So this is up to now also not a working solution. So we were left by just applying a UV filter, which is, of course, not the most elegant way, but at least a working way. And so we put a UV filter on top. And then, of course, as I said, if you put it in our UV chamber and it's just dark, then it's not really meaningful. So we thought, OK, let's put it really under the real sun, where we have some where we can measure the efficiency. And we have the UV light and cut off a part of it and then see if it helps. So this is very preliminary results, only 1,500 hours up to now. But as you can see, with a glass encapsulation and without a UV filter, the blue curve triangles, down-facing triangles, you see, OK, it's degrading quite fast outdoors. And if we apply this UV filter, it's much more stable. And the very encouraging story is that if you use a 3M barrier and this Delo LPP655 glue, we can also make flexible devices which are as stable as glass devices. And most importantly, this is the degradation of the fill factor, which was the main feature in the degradation under UV. And you see this is it's just flat now with a UV filter under auto. So this seemingly degradation in the efficiency could also be a temperature effect or so, I don't know. We have to just wait now for longer times. And so we were quite optimistic that we have a nice system here. And we thought, OK, let's face the 8585 challenge now. And we saw a lot of results yesterday on 6585, which is also, of course, important. But I think if you really want bankability on the roof or in the field, there is a few chance to argue around 8585. And the Holt Center has also shown that it's possible that it's not the organic layers which are the problem. This is a very important message, I think. And here, of course, it's also interesting if it's possible with some, at least somehow more realistic package like these 3M barrier or Polo barrier. And we had this result, OK, for the 1,000-hour test, we can do it, and of course, as a scientist, you do it longer. And we thought, okay, it was luck. And we have a very sudden decrease in the efficiency, so a sudden death problem. And when we looked to the device, it became very obvious what happened. And in this device layout, we use the low work function electrode comes out of the package. We anticipated that this might be a problem and kept it by a gold layer, so we thought this should help and stabilize it, and maybe it does, so we survived 1,000 hours, but still there are some scratches in the gold, and especially at this border where the glass is pressed on the cell, you have probably some defects sometimes, and there you see that the corrosion of the aluminum starts, and the interesting thing is it does not only degrade where the spot is, but it really grows, it starts to move towards the inside to the package. So you open up a degradation path into the package by this aluminum, which is eaten up more or less and gets transparent. And then it just goes and goes and goes. And at some point, it reaches the part where there's no gold capping anymore. And then you just very, very short, on very short time scale, you just disconnect your solar cell from your outside contacts. And then you lose, of course, you cannot measure anything anymore, but the organic PV solar cell is still working. So it's a quite trivial failure mechanism, which of course can be solved. This is just what happens if you wait for more time, and on this pixel 2, you see okay, it's completely disconnected. You know? And this is the point where you measure nothing anymore. So it's quite clear. And okay, we thought, okay, this is easy to solve. We just use a new mask. So we evaporate the low work function metal only in regions which are encapsulated and only the gold comes out. So this is, of course, not a solution for a product. But I think for testing different device decks in laboratory tests, it's a very, very important thing that you don't fail for these trivial reasons, because it's not reflecting your device deck properties, but it's just reflecting your encapsulation scheme. So this is a good thing to do, I would say. And of course, we repeat it, and then of course you can go for longer time scales, and you can also do it with flexible films like this Polo barrier film or 3M barrier film with the Delo glue. It's also possible to survive this 85-85 for more than 1,000 hours. Which is, of course, very nice to have it also on ITO-free devices. And this brings me to my conclusion. So we have ITO-free devices which fulfill this IEC standard under damp heat condition. We have also very promising stability under thermal stress and continuous illumination with visible light. We have a serious UV problem, of course, in these devices, and it's probably similar to this Holz device, which also degraded quite fast in this test, so I think the same mechanism is working there. So a UV filter will probably help, as you said. And we could really, with a combination of different experimental methods and also with the help of the ISOS community, really pinpoint that it's the PDOT-PSS electrode which increases in resistance and therefore inhibits the current extraction, and we could also see that the UV filter really makes a difference under outdoor exposure, that it's really helping. It's also important. And I want to thank, of course, my group, which is here, and also Ines Dürr, who is head of the team analytics of photovoltaic modules at ISE, who made the 85-85 tests and so on. And of course, a special thanks to our PhD students, Urbana Sapkota, who also published these very nice results in two papers. Okay, thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to answer questions.
Thank you, Peter, for solving some older issues. And thanks for staying in time so well. So we regain some of our coffee break. Is there a question now to be asked within the auditorium? Yes.
I was just curious as to what the spacing between your silver grid was.
1 millimeter.
1 millimeter.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Obviously, the degradation would be much worse if that spacing were larger.
It depends, of course, on the conductivity of your period. We use a conductivity of about 1,000 ohm square because we want to have really thin layers to have the highest possible transparency.
This is the pH 1000.
No, it's we started with CPP 105, okay. And now we use FHC solar.
Okay.
It's much more conductive. It's 200 ohms or so. And of course, if you have a higher conductivity, you can increase the space, or you can keep it as it is and gain instability. But of course, this is riskier because you have this. It will at some point it will start, and then the extrapolation is not valid. Yeah.
Okay. If there is no more urgent question, let's postpone all the questions to the coffee break, and let's meet again here at 11. Thank you.